Name of woman. Just a little note to say I was thinking of you. I'll never forget your color of hair. The way it looked splayed across my pillow as the sun kissed your face that morning we were together. And yes, name of woman, hard time and name of resort is something I'll always hold dear to me. The moments we spend apart really aren't apart because you play in my brain, even though you may be far away. You know, it's funny, but whenever I walk down name of street, I always think it's kind of a special street because you live on it. And I kind of tingle thinking maybe you'll poke your head out of a doorway or a store and we'll meet and maybe have another encounter. And whenever I see your make of car, I always start for a second, and my heart leaps into my mouth thinking maybe that's you driving along and we'll fall into formation together and kind of smile and say, your face or mine. You know, I did something silly the other day. I went to the department store and bought a bottle of brand of perfume so that I could open it at night and make believe you're with me, even when you're not. I just wrote to say, my little name of woman, hi, love, Nino. Okay, Miss Hotchkiss, would you come in here and run off about 500 of these, please?
Rush.
A little morning showers. One of those days that's supposed to get better as it wears on, with a high temp of the upper 80s today, partly cloudy for tomorrow, 80s continued mugger. Right now, 72 at DC 101. Commander von Tucker's face here in front of the Sennheiser, 19 minutes after 7. It's kind of overcast this morning. They say it should be a sunny day today. It's been like that the last several days. Starts out ugly, but then the sun, by lunchtime, is out there, baking the winos into an overripe state of fetid existence. Oh, God, it'll be in the upper 80s today, and the upper 80s tomorrow. And right now, let me see, 72 degrees, DC 101. All right, buddy, sorry to keep you dangling. Now, you tell me you've been listening to me for a long time.
Yeah, and, I don't know how you go out pump iron and things like that.
Yeah.
I'm a reasonably ectomorphic person, and I've decided that I'm going to change my evil ways, and I'm going to get bold, proud, and bulky. So last night I went out and bought me 170-some pounds worth of weight in the bench press with leg lifts and all that good stuff.
Yeah?
I need a bit of an incentive. I can't remember how that tune went, but that one iron pumping tune you used to do a little bit ago?
Beef it?
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah!
Yeah, how about slapping that on for me this morning so I can get my blood pressure going?
You got it, buddy. My pleasure is a man. My mouth full of desiccated liver. Way to weight gain power. Let's pump it. You've always been such a scrawny young man. You need some muscle mass, you could use a tan. You better pump up, better lift what you can. So beef it, just beef it. Your delts are pumped, you know they're A number one. You make love like a piston, she's glad when you're done. You don't need no karate, you don't need no gun when you're beefing. But you wanna get big, so beef it, beef it, beef it, beef it. Do another rep, repeat it. You gotta do triceps, you gotta do the bench. If you get real massive, you'll bag that wench. So beef it, beef it, beef it, beef it. Do another rep, repeat it. Your legs are huge, you know they're pumped to the max. They're just so massive, they won't fit in your slacks. You know I ain't bragging, buddy, them are the facts. When you're beefing, just beefing. You walk with pride, you got that confident feeling. With every heavy step, the plaster falls from the ceiling. Your gym bag smells so bad, you'll walk away reeling when you're beefing. But you wanna get big, so beef it, beef it, beef it, beef it. Do another rep, repeat it. You gotta do triceps, you gotta do the bench. If you get real massive, you'll bag that wench. So beef it, beef it, David, David knew another rap recruiter. You gotta be awesome, you gotta be ripped. When summertime comes, you'll walk around stripped when you're beefing. Beefing, beefing, beefing. You'll start your day knocking down them raw eggs. A big, big protein drink of Wiener weight gain. Followed by 30, maybe 40 desiccated liver pills. Yeah, you knock down them vitamins. And then you rap out. Rip it till you rip your joints right from the sockets. You'll pump that iron till the day that you die. God will give you wings, but you'll be too big to fly. You'll be the biggest angel that ever hit the sky. If you beef it, just beef it. And when you get to heaven, you won't have to wait. You'll be strong enough to just bend open the pearly gates. Then hit a double bicep as the angels salivate when you beef it. But you want to get big, so beef it, beef it, beef it, beef it. Another rep, repeat it. You gotta work triceps, you gotta do bench. If you get real massive, you'll bag that wench. So beef it, beef it, beef it, beef it. Do another rep, repeat it. You gotta be awesome, you gotta get ripped. When summertime comes, you'll walk around stripped if you beef it. Hair overalls on. Oftentimes they go around country people too. Well, you know, I'll get out riding in West Virginia. Oftentimes, rather than stay at a hotel, I'll just rely on country hospitality. Stopped this one place, told him I was traveling along, didn't have a place to go, but I would pay him for a little food and a place to stay. They let me stay in the barn or something I keep an eye out for. They said, oh, no, come on in. So I went inside, and there was a farmer and his wife. We sat down, we had us a great meal. I said, well, I guess I'll head out to the barn. He said, you ain't gonna head out to no barn. I said, you look like a clean fella. Smell nice. I said, Aquavella. He said, well, whatever. Tell you what, you can sleep with us. I'll just sleep in the middle, keep things on the up and up. My wife on one side, you on the other. I said, well, I guess so, sure. And sure enough, we get into bed, and that guy's sound asleep. Well, we'd been passing around the bottle of Jack Black and laughing, swapping stories. We hit the rack, he's sound asleep and a-snoring. And his wife kind of smiles, leans over him, pushes my shoulder, and says, come on, big boy. Come on, baby. I said, my gosh, your husband's right there. She said, oh, he sleeps like a log. Watch this. And she grabs a strand of Tecostal foliage and winds it around her finger. And then just rears it back, pulls it right out. I said, holy deal, you're up. That guy's still snoring up a storm. So I figured, what the hey? Don't want to look a gift horse in the mouth. We commenced to have us a bodacious time. But, I kept looking, but he was sleeping through it. I had one eye out there. Had one eye kind of looking off at him, just to make sure he didn't stir. But no, he just slept right through. So I cuddled up, I grabbed me the pillow, I rolled over to my side of the bed. I figured, oh, yes, yes, yes. But she rubs my shoulder again. She says, come on. I said, what do you mean, come on? We done did. She said, but I just getting started. I said, well, I done finished. She said, oh, come on, pretty buddy. Sure enough, she's rubbing the small of my back, and them little blonde hairs in the small of my back just stand right up. And they say, you know, I'm fired up again. I said, but he's going to wake up for sure, baby. She said, he ain't going to wake up. And she reaches down there, grabs another strand of Tecostal foliage. She winds that thing around her finger. She rears and pulls that thing. Ah. Sure enough, I just tear it up again. What the hey, you know? And I can't believe my eyes. I mean, the bed is a-rollicking. I mean, the man's head even hit the wall a couple of times. Still snoring. Finally exhausted. I retreat to my corner of the bed, bundle up in the fetal position, get them covers all snug up around my neck. Ah, a big meal, a little relaxing diversion. I'm ready to sleep. But she says, come on, big boy, please, please, please. I said, my God, are you sure? She says, see for yourself. So I go ahead and I wind a strand of that man took out the foliage around my finger and I pull it right out. Oh. Finally, he sits straight up and looks me right in the face. He says, "Buddy, I don't mind y'all having some fun, but do you have to keep score on my pool game?"
Make yourself comfortable. Adjustable steering, it's ideal.
Yeah, we rock. At the last of the rockets, DC-101. How's your car running? Check that thing out. Is it purring like a kitten? Or is it acting up? Is it a little color care? Well, maybe you should head for Precision Tune. For just $39.40, your worries are over. For just $39.40, you're saving gasoline. For just $39.40, you get the pep. The pep that that car had when it came off the line so many years ago. And if you hit it right, you don't have to leave it. I mean, you know, leaving the car, I hate that. Leave the car. God, what a pain in the tuckers leaving the car is, you know? But Precision Tune, they usually take about 45 minutes to a complete tune-up. Checking belts, hoses, engine oil, things that you never check when you go to the You Pump It Pump. And you can stop by before work. A lot of times you just do it on your lunch hour. Or maybe on the way home. Either way, they're flexible. You don't have to leave the car. God, that's awful. They'll test it on the dynamometer, and you're on your way for just $39.40. No hidden costs, no add-ons, and that thing is guaranteed. So call 340-TUNE for the exact address and phone number of the Precision Tune nearest you. That's 340-TUNE. And get that thing running right.
Kohl's Ford does it again with a fantastic end-of-the-month, end-of-the-model...
For the grease man here at Action Central, taking care of the early morning doings, making sure everything is perky. Let's see who's notables in town. Oh, Liz Taylor's in town. Liz Taylor's in town with his spilt new bob. Liz Taylor. Of course, she always stays at the Vista Hotel. It's a really nice place. Not far from here. I done walked in there gawking. I done had my wang tips on the carpet of the Vista one time or two, just when she was here the last time, staying at the Vista with Victor Luna. Victor Luna! Yeah, because she's a woman alone now. She's available. Yeah, she dropped Victor. She dropped 30, 40 pounds. I might just have to send a box of Mallow Mars over there. With best regards, Nina. Oh. But I don't know if I can use Mallow Mars to woo her anymore. Now that she's lost all that weight, I may have to find another tack. Well, I remember when she was beefy, I had the best time in the world trying to track her down. Last time she was here, I paid big bucks for the room directly over hers. Because Victor, he's pretty jealous. Not only that, he tried to keep her under lock and key so she wouldn't sneak out and get her a big old case of Mallow Mars and wallow in him. He had people with her all the time to make sure all she ate was cantaloupe slices and lettuce. I mean, she had a Mallow Mar craving like you wouldn't believe. So I got me out my Shakespeare fishing rod and my Garcia fishing reel, and I loaded that thing up with 70-pound test. Got me a box of Mallow Mars, stuck that pole out the window, put a hook on the end of that thing, baited up a Mallow Mar, and I just lowered it in front of Liz's room. That thing wasn't dangling there 30 seconds before I heard the window slide open and she reached out for it, and I just kind of jerked it up a little bit. I said, "Come on out, Liz, come on out." Sure enough, there was an ample ledge, so she climbed out in her 90, still reaching for that Mallow Mar. Victor was saying, "Please, my gringita, come back to me." She said, "Shut up, Victor. I've had it with you and all that Latin foolery. Just shut up. Just shut up." And she started inching her way across the ledge toward the Mallow Mar, which I just kept an inch or two out of her grasp. Finally, I let her grab it, and hungrily, she sucked it off the hook like a crab at the bottom of the Chesapeake. She sucked it off the hook. She said, "More." I said, "I have a whole box, Liz. The hook to your bodice." Yeah, she was wearing some kind of heavy-duty night apparel, some kind of bodice. So she hooked that hook to it, and I started reeling her in. She just hung there limply as I reeled her up to my floor, but unfortunately the weight was too much, even for my heavy-duty deep-sea fishing rig. And I had to loosen the drag to keep the line from breaking. And when I loosened the drag, she started heading down, down. By now a crowd had gathered in the streets. Arms extended to greet her. She screamed, "Throw the Mallow Mars! Throw the Mallow Mars!"
I threw them. What the hell, I threw them and they hit the pavement with a whack. The box burst open and they scattered. Velomar's rolling everywhere. She hit the street, she pushed away from her rescuers. She dove to the sidewalk, tracking down the Velomars, some of them half stepped on by well-meaning passers-by. She scraped them up from the sidewalk and ate them hungrily. A couple rolled in the gutter, she rolled in right after them, picking them off the sewage grates, lunging those Velomars into her face. Finally, Victor came down, grabbed her, hauled her bodily across the lobby of the hotel, took her up to the room and threw her there on the bed, smearing the sheets with the grime from the gutter and the halfway melted Velomars that covered her face. She lay there, poured herself a double vodka, lit up a Winston, blowing smoke in Victor's face, and finally said, "Take me. Take me now!" He looked at her smeared form, the grime on her bodice, the mellow moths oozing all over the covers. Being a proud, bold man, he did what he had to do. He took a shot of tequila straight from the bottle, and then he took her. As Liz fell into a drunken sleep in the aftermath. And I think that's the incident that kind of shamed her into losing all that weight. Because in the morning, when she awoke, she was shocked to find a human arm that had been chewed off at the shoulder.
The critics go bonkers over Buckaroo Banzai. The oddest good movie in many a full moon. Time Magazine, bless its demented little heart. Newsweek, coolest of the cool, hippest of the hip, Los Angeles Times. 20th Century Fox presents The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai Across the Eighth Dimension.
No matter where you go, there you are.
Rated PG. Parental guidance suggested.
Hey, starts Friday. Check newspapers for theaters and showtimes.
Because you...
I can't believe people. Just because I'm a Clint Eastwood fan, and just because he's a bold, proud man, would think that I would actually want him in any other way but a manly way, friend to friend, bold men, proud men. And to think that Clint Eastwood go... You know if Clint Eastwood ever heard those stories? Buddy, I'd be hating life. Now, I just joke around a little bit, but obviously some people are a little insecure. So we'll just strike them from the record and we'll do something else. Maybe I'll tap dance or something, I don't know. It still bugs me, though, because I think it's so ridiculous. That's the reason I do it. It's ridiculous. The thought that Clint Eastwood would ever take a walk out of the wild side, the thought that me would, come on. You know, but there is always that possibility. Say, for example, I was coming back from the gym one day, walking bold, proud, good pump, gym bag swinging, feeling the sun on my face, and Clinton was, directing traffic at an intersection, and like a truck went by with radioactive materials and hit a bump, and a big barrel of radioactive stuff fell into the street, and I walked over to take a look at it, and Clinton walked over to take a look at it, and the barrel opened, and all this green stuff came out, and we both glowed for a second, and then they cleaned it up and washed it away and left Clinton and I standing there, and because of those rays that had permeated our brain, he looked up at me, and I looked up at him, and before we knew what was happening... knowing why, he'd reach out and take my hand, and I, not knowing why, returned the pressure. And I smiled shyly as he would turn to me and say, "Okay, punk, your face or mine." And we'd both turn and we'd run to his squad car. We'd hit the lights in Cyrene there, and parting the traffic like Moses parted the Red Sea, we'd rush toward our Shangri-La. Then, in the aftermath, as we shared a camel, we'd realize we were on the brink of something. I'd fluff the pillow as Clint took a last drag from his bottle of Jack Black and fell over into a noisy, snoring, drunken sleep. And I, lying there on one elbow, smiling, looking at Clinton, as his tocostal foliage waved gently to and fro from the breeze created by the air conditioner, I'd probably sit there and grab a strand and say, "He loves me."
He loves me not. He loves me. He loves me not. Let me see here. This one's a little slippery. He loves me. He loves me not.
For a dose of cool in your carpool, don't touch that dial. It's the Grease Man on DC 101.
I didn't say I had to do something.
They took you what?
Gallbladder.
Your gallbladder? Yeah. You done been cut off?
No. They'd never stop that.
No, I said you've been cut off. How long? I mean, how old are you, baby?
I'm old. 39 is old. 39.
You're one of my...
Huh?
You're one of my upper strata. I knew it was a gallbladder operation. You couldn't be no chicken.
Is that...
39 years old. Listen to you, that husky laugh, singed by years of double vodkas and endless packs of Winstons.
You're horrible. I don't
want to... Yeah, listen to it. Abused, abandoned.
I'm not abused, abandoned.
No?
No.
Are you married?
I don't have a situation.
You say what?
I had a situation.
You had a situation, yeah, but then he left. Used and abandoned. Now look at you. Now look at you. Sitting there, caked. Hair matted to the side of your head, Winston dangling from your lips. 39 years of age and no gallbladder. God. And they ask you why you drink.
The heat is on for a new pair of TV detectives with a burning desire for the steamy side of crime.
It was murder, just like you thought. A harpoon right through his back.
Alive. Yes.
Oh, bet I got you beat, though. It's the oldest woman you ever been with. Yeah, a lot of people been with, 50 and above. A mother's friend that one day comes over to borrow a cup of sugar. But I bet you I got you beat. Yeah. 87. 87 years of age, buddy. I remember it to this day. A lot of people say, Grease Man, how could you stand it? Those watery eyes gazing at you, the false teeth clicking, the old broken voice, those gnarled chicken skin covered fingers digging at your back. Oh, come on, why? What do you think, I was sick? Hell, none of that happened, for crying out loud. She passed away a couple hours earlier. It was rather nice, actually.
If you think he's crazy, you ought to see his mama.
Hey!
The Grease Man on DC 101.
Wounded and numb, he still was undaunted in his ever continuing fight against injustice, against inequality, and his fight for the American way. So he took his ordinary wheelchair and he took it into a metal shop, and with his blowtorch going, he added machine guns. He added Laws surface-to-air missiles. He added a big bulletproof blade in the back. He supercharged that thing with a 454 overhead cam fuel-injected engine and became Wheelchair Warrior. Prowling the streets on full disability pension, Wheelchair Warrior had full time to devote to his day. Looking down at the scanner that he had built into the wheelchair, he adjusted it for all the police frequencies, checking his video monitor behind him. So no one could sneak up on him. He began his patrol. Suddenly, of a police channel 4. Robbery in progress, robbery in progress, 109 Blauman Boulevard. So instead of moving his wheelchair by hand, he decides to crank that thing up. Crank that thing up so he can head there at full speed to render aid. He's Wheelchair Warrior. In pursuit. He test fires his guns just to make sure they're working. Satisfied, it's full speed ahead. His long hair blowing back. His headband keeping it out of his eyes. Big, powerful, muscular arms from using that wheelchair. He gets on the scene. Sure enough, the robbers are just coming out. Sawed-off shotguns, big bags of money. He stops and says, "Halt! Wheelchair Warrior!" They turn as if to fire. He dodges behind a mailbox and just opens up! Flying in the air. People are dying. force of it pushes him back against the parked car. But he still holds those buttons in the full auto position. Blowing away those maggots! When suddenly in the distance, it looks like the guy that was waiting in the getaway car is going to take off. He flips up his automatic sighting scope and opens fire with a surface-to-air missile. Sayonara, maggot! He's blown the kingdom come, and the townspeople rejoice. Another exciting case for Wheelchair Warrior. When suddenly, a policeman runs up and says, "Hey, you! You're the guy in a wheelchair. What do you think you're doing anyway? You got a license for that thing? You got a license to have an auto? You ain't got no signals on this thing. You ain't got no traffic lights, number one. Number two, you ain't got a license for automatic weapon. Number three, you ain't got a license for surface-to-air missiles. And number four, we are the police. We handle this. You blew up half the street. You blew up all the money. You blew up three people's lives that might have been able to have been taken alive. In short, you're messing with something that ain't yours. I'm going to teach you a lesson you'll never forget. And that cop grabs the wheelchair warrior, grabs him and brutalizes him. But the wheelchair warrior just smiles, says, "Hey, officer, the joke's on you, buddy. I can't feel anything from the waist down."
Make yourself comfortable.
Yeah, let's see here. Oh, God, rain today, parks are clearing tomorrow. No. And Sunday, mostly cloudy and cool. 60s today, 50s for tomorrow. Right now, 48 degrees at DC 101.
And now it would rain buckets for 2 months. I mean, here we get a rain like this, it lasts for a few hours, maybe a day. Imagine 2 months of non-stop rain!
And as I stared out of the window here at DC 101, smoking a Camel quietly, I looked in the street, and it almost looked like the people were wearing black pajamas. And if I listened, I could almost hear those voices.
Those voices!
Stop it!
The memories won't leave me alone. Back from the days when the name on my uniform said Grease Manelli, but everybody knew me as Sergeant Fury. Crying Tree, 1967. We were out on patrol, and we were hungry. We've been on search and destroy, force recon, for 3 weeks. And if you've ever eaten sea rations for any length of time, you get so sick of them. I mean, how many cans of peaches and tuna fish can you eat? How many canned brownies can you eat? Canned beef stroganoff. Barf, barf. And one day we saw this water buffalo standing there in this field. I said, "Boys, that looks like a communist water buffalo to me. Doesn't look like a communist water buffalo to you." He said, "Yes, sir, it does." I said, "Well, then, as a communist water buffalo, we have a duty to assault that thing." We watched as that big beast is kind of keeled over and sploosh into the rice paddy. We hauled it out of there. We started the biggest fire you ever saw. Took a big steak, ran it through the bomb bay doors, out the mouth, and we rotated that thing like a rotisserie. I tell you what, buddy, after several hours under that roaring blaze... My God! Did you men just eat that water buffalo? I said, "Why, yeah, Lieutenant, we did. Why?" He said, "My God, that was a test water buffalo. The Army is testing special drugs, special defoliants for the reaction on animals. We're testing drugs for the reaction on people. We're testing every drug known to man on this water buffalo, and you just ate it?" We all looked at each other, and suddenly nobody could lift a fork. He said, "Keep me abreast of your progress. My God." Well, it's like we'd all received a death sentence. We didn't know what to make of it. I started feeling vertigo. I started feeling strange sensations. I dropped my fork. I stood up. I started milling around. The other men I could see by the confused looks on their faces were feeling the same way. But we didn't have time to consider our illnesses for very long. We didn't have time. time to consider what was happening to us for very long. Because as we walked through the camp, I heard a sound that suddenly brought me back to reality. The sound of enemy weapons opening up! Outgunned. Suddenly I started to fade away. I felt this pain in my back. I felt this pain in my back as something was sprouting from my back. I looked around and the other guys had dropped their guns and they were kind of clawing at their backs. But it looked as though we were sprouting wings. We could hear the enemy weapons fire in the distance. And we were sprouting wings. Something in that buffalo had genetically affected us. And wings started coming out of our backs. I took off my shirt and my gun. Wings about 4 or 5 feet long. And I could move them like any other part of my body. They were going shoosh, 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 shoosh. And I looked around and there was Robinson, Kalachecki, DiLorenzo, Prokopic, Perez, Carter, Wozniewski. All of them with wings. I tried, and sure enough, I could lift myself up and down in the foxhole. All the other men were lifting themselves slightly off the ground with their wings. I said, men, grab your M16s. Let's give Charlie a surprise he'll never forget. And so we took off the ground. We became the Winged Warriors of Death. And as we flew toward the enemy positions, they didn't shoot. They just saw us flying. In camouflage, M16 and port arms. They turned, they ran, screaming, I said, all right, men, open up! Yeah, there's one on the ground there, he's mine! Cease firing, damn you! You're wasting the government's money, and sure enough, we flew back. Settled down gently in the camp. I said, hey, I'm gonna have some more of that water buffalo. This is great! Oh, but you know, suddenly I got this tremendous pain in my guts. This agonizing pain, and I said, from that, I thought I had to take a massive constitutional, but all the men said, sorry, what is it? What is it? I said, I don't know. I dropped my britches and I began to lay an egg. I couldn't believe it. The men all backed off. They were shocked when suddenly I looked and there was an egg about 3 feet in diameter. And it started to crack and open up. And this little guy came out, this little mini thing came out, and I kind of backed off with the rest of the guys. We circled it wide-eyed in shock. And it started looking at us saying, and it came toward me, and I said, will you look there? When suddenly we all collapsed, something seized at us. We all hit the ground. Some of us threw up. Other men fainted there. And as I looked, our wings started shrinking. Our wings started shrinking and receding back into our backs. And I finally got to my knees, and my wings were gone. My buddy's wings were gone. And that little thing that hatched from me was dead. Everybody went running over to us and said, my God, hey, let me get a picture. Let me hold it. You take a picture of me holding it, and I'll take a picture of you holding it, all right? They'll never believe it. I said, get back! Oh, you get back! Get back! There will be no picture taking. There will be no posing with this thing. This thing is a part of me. And it's going to be treated with respect, do you hear me? And I picked up that poor little lifeless thing. I said, respect! I spat in their faces. As I turned and I walked away to my foxhole. And to this day, I still have it. Yeah.
sitting in a jar of formaldehyde on my coffee table.
John Riggin, for the new Ford Rangers.
The one good thing about playing the hits, you can forget the Sennheiser. It's easy to drift away from the maggotry. But I remember in the days when I had another job that you couldn't leave behind. It's a job you take with you wherever you go. A proud job. Time to wonder what it must be like. To strap on a gun and pin on a badge and become a lawman. Yeah, you're headed off to your Hawaiian vacation there, but you're still carrying that big magnum with you. As you get to the airport, you go through the metal detector and they say, I'm sorry, sir, you whip out your badge. You say, I'm a lawman on vacation. I'm headed to Hawaii, and I got my magnum with me. They say, I'm sorry, sir, but I don't care if you are a lawman. It's a federal regulation that no one except federal air marshals is allowed to possess a firearm. You say, let me tell you something, you maggot there, and you jack him up against the wall. He says, I'm sorry, sir, it's just a regulation. You say, all right, here's a magnum, here's my card. Send it to me when I get back. He says, all right, I will, sir, but I'm very sorry. But you say, all right, little as you know, you still get another one strapped to your ankle as you get on board that plane. Well, no sooner is the plane airborne when terrorists, somehow having smuggled weaponry on board, jump up and say, all right, this plane is going to Tehran. You say, no, it ain't, hot shot. As you leap up, unsnapping that magnum and open up, a gun battle blazes away right there in the aisle. Passengers are diving. Windows are punctured, causing rapid decompression as passengers are sucked out into the air. Everything goes flying. But you manage to blow away all the maggots until you look to your horror at the cockpit door. Bullet holes. You kick it down, and sure enough, there's the pilot and the co-pilot slumped over the controls. My God! The rest of the passengers, the pandemonium breaks out amongst the survivors as you pull the pilot away from the seat. And you light up a Camel and you sit down. You hit the intercom and say, all you yucca bucks back there who gave up smoking in the last 5 years, don't you feel stupid now, huh? We'll probably be splattered in a matter of minutes. Ah! As you figure out how to try to land that thing. Well, you get emergency instructions from the control tower on the Hawaiian island of Kamanawanalea. And as you head in, the guy says, you got the Vector. You say, Vector, what do I know from Vector? Vector, Schmector, here, I'm a cop, here I come. You kick your way out of a cockpit window. You hit the tarmac as the whole thing blows. You stand there and you watch the flames as they cook 'em. In an interesting afternote, as they're carrying you away in the ambulance. Yeah, they scoop you off the ground. They throw you in that ambulance to the hospital. You're lying there on the stretcher, and one of the ambulance attendants says to the other one, what's going on here? We burning brake linings in this thing again? You just smile and say, no, I think it's my tocostal foliage smoldering, but I'll be all right.
Here's news.
If I should happen to glance out the window and see that the moon is full, I suddenly feel myself undergoing a change. I'll say, no, don't touch that blind. Why not? It's a pretty moon outside. Let's take a look at it. No, please. Believe me, oh, God. That's when the women always look at me and say, what's the matter? So when I drop to my knees and my eyes glow green, and I feel my skin start buckling. Lumps coming up on my flesh. My fingernails turning into claws. Hair on my body. And that's when I approach the women. And I eat them! I eat them! Then is the morning. I've awakened to find myself in a bloody sheet with bones and gnarled pieces of fish lying around the bed. I find women, yes, but I eat them! I eat them! That's how come I know you didn't see me with an IP. Because I don't
need IPs. I tried once, and I nearly gagged on the Velcro. I mean, I snapped out of my wolfman-like trance immediately. I started gagging. I was running around the backyard yelling, It was most unsavory.
Here's news for...
Oh, no, let me see. What else have I written? Well, a few.
A few I've written. A few? I'm working on a funky one, too, you know, because I am an equal opportunity songwriter. Eh? Yeah. I got it kind of down. I laid down the track so far, but kind of working on it. Because I figure, you know, for a honky, I am pretty funky. Yeah? The song I've written is called The Velcro Blues. Oh, I love that Velcro. Got to have that Velcro. Yes, I love the Velcro. I got the Velcro Blues. My house is cool ever since I put that Velcro on the floor. My children hang from the roof. They hang from the floor. Don't pay no sitters. Just go out the door. Cause I love that Velcro. It minds my kids from me. That Velcro keeps them dangling naturally. I got to have it everywhere I go. Need it here in D.C. and up in Baltimore. Lord, I love that Velcro. Got to have that Velcro. Yes, I need that Velcro hanging on my door. That Velcro, got to have that Velcro. Yes, I need that Velcro. Stick it on the floor. My car's a fast one, moves in every lane. When I'm in a collision, Lord, I don't feel the pain. My car is safety laden. Safety is the best. I got Velcro slapped back on that headrest. So I love that little Velcro. I take it everywhere. Stick that Velcro inside Pappy's chair. That Velcro hooks his Picasso foliage. He can't get up. He's safe. He don't hit the floor no more. Lord, I love that Velcro. Got to have that Velcro. Got that Velcro hanging on my ceiling floor. Got to have that Velcro. Yes, I need that Velcro. Got to have that Velcro. I can't stand it anymore. Yeah!
How'd you do, Charlie?
Pretty good. I'm getting the hang of that target detection system.
It's sort of like...
Like a great video game.
Yeah. We've got a future in the Navy.
It's pretty good for tonight, too. Going into town?
Sure. How often do you get to Hong Kong?
Pretty often.
Navy. Most jobs promise you the world. The Navy delivers.
Want to try a video game?
Are you kidding? After what we do?
Oh, come
Navy.
On.
It's not just a job. It's an adventure. See your recruiter or call 800-327-NAVY. Sponsored by the U.S. Navy.
At McDonald's, we make breakfast the way you like it.
I'm a morning person.
Me, I'm not.
I like to eat my breakfast nice and slow.
I'd rather sleep late.
Sip a nice hot cup of coffee with my fresh scrambled eggs.
I like to grab an egg, McMuffin, to go. McDonald's is our breakfast place, on that we agree.
Yeah, let me take it easy.
They're best for me.
It's a good time for the great taste of McDonald's.
Here's news for field engineers and electronic technicians from Ford Aerospace and Communications Corporation in the Baltimore-Washington corridor. It's an open house today for electronic techs and field engineers to learn about exciting opportunities with Ford Aerospace in the Baltimore-Washington area and assignments to the United Kingdom with your family. The open house is today at the Columbia Holiday Inn, Routes 1 and 175 in Jessup, from 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Sure to come if you have two or more years of direct field experience, neither analog, digital, or RF systems and equipment repair, and you must be a U.S. citizen. At today's open house from 11 to 9 p.m. at the Columbia Holiday Inn, there will be continuous presentations about Ford Aerospace programs, security considerations, a travel film on the United Kingdom, light snacks and refreshments. No appointment necessary. Just drop in at the Ford Aerospace Open House Columbia Holiday Inn
from 11 to 9 p.m. today.
Okay, buddy. 21 minutes before 8. Here, DC 101, the Grease Man here, continuing with our 2 for Tuesday. This is Genesis on DC 101. That's all right. Yeah, I thought I'd do a little devotional right now. What do you think? What do you think? You want to? You know, just for a second? Let's do it together.
Wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior. Then Jesus came like a savior in the night. And I said, praise the Lord.
Come on, everybody.
I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. I said, praise the Lord. Just like a blind man wandered along, worries and fears I claim for my own. Then like a blind man who God gave back his sight, I said, praise the Lord. I saw the light, I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
You created everything with a reason in mind. Tell me, sir, what was the reason for the boils on Estelle's behind? Now, maybe you had your reasons, buddy, but that was nasty! And now the sneeze back, sister.
I was a fool to wander and stray.
Yeah, baby.
Straight is the gate and narrow the way.
Uh-huh.
Now I have traded wrong for the
right. What'd you say? The cross. Why didn't you hock some lungers on them, boss? I mean, to get them, let them get away with that just ain't right. I mean, praise the Lord, I saw the light. Let's take it home now.
I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
I said, praise.
Carpool. Don't touch that dial. It's the Grease Man on DC 101.
Sweet. No, I just want to... I don't have any, you know, my motives... Keep in mind, she's a young girl. My motives are not untoward. My motives are all very... I just want to be her friend. I had a dream about her last night. I don't know what it is, you know. I was just thumbing through a magazine and had, you know, some facts and figures about Mary Lou, and I fell asleep, and I... I dreamt that we had a date for Halloween. Yeah, but, you know, well, you know, she can still trick-or-treat. She puts a little gremlin's outfit on. She looks, you know, trick-or-treat, hi. Stand on my hands for a little treat. I'm Mary Lou. Well, last night I dreamt that I was
Gotta take her to the DC-101 costume party we're having Saturday night at the old post office. And as I picked her up, I said hi to Mom and Pop Retton. We drove away. I said, hon, before we go to the costume party, what do you say we stop and get lunch? She said, what do you want to have, Neen? I said, oh, let's go to Benny's Burrito Palace. What do you say? She said, oh, Mexican chow again. I love it spicy. I said, so do I, baby, so do I. So we went and knocked out 3 burritos apiece. She said, I can't take the suspense anymore. What's our Halloween costume going to be? I said, well, it's kind of an old idea, but I think we'll have fun doing it. We're going to go as a horse. A big old floppy horse. You ever seen those horse costumes? Takes 2 people to wear them. One person's in front, one person's in the back. She said, oh, yeah, I seen it. The 3 Stooges used to wear them all the time and go bumping into everything. I said, exactly. And I've rented one of those. And there it is in the back. Why don't you take it out? And here we are at the old post office now. Let's put this thing on. Mary Lou looked at me and said, well, oh, can I steer? Can I be in the shore? Sure, you can be in the front, darling. Yeah. How did you get in? Hey, well, no. Slide in. I'll be the horse's tongue. That's kind of figure. That's the kind of guy I am anyway, right? Okay, here, I'll get in the back. All right, now you have to walk for it because I can't see where we're going. You know, your behind is blocking my view. Let me zip us up here. It's going to be a little muggy in the air. Might get just a little close, but... Don't worry about me, hon. You just have fun. And so, in the horse's costume, Mary Lou and I made our way to the DC-101 Halloween Ball. She said, are you okay back there, Neen? You're not getting too hot. I had one nostril shut at the time, and I was going, no, honey, I'm fine. I'm fine. Let's go a little faster, okay? She said, I'd like to, Neen, but I'm getting all sweaty. I said, that's okay, baby. That's okay. Yeah. Say hi to everybody. Yeah, keep them off. We're representing the... Yeah, that's right. Yeah, here we go. Oh, fun. Fun. And so, that's how the dream went on. Me and Mary Lou in the horse's suit. As time went on... Got a little close in there. But I wouldn't permit her to unzip the suit. She could breathe rather well, being in the front part with the little mouth of the horse and the little nose. But there I was, in the dank bowels of the horse, as it were. And eventually, I was asphyxiated. But I remember the dream had kind of a comical end. As they unzipped the suit... and pulled me out. I was blue from lack of oxygen. Blue from methane poisoning. I remember it took 3 undertakers 5 days to get the smile off my face.
The super dealer, Spencer Toy.
What's a ninja? It's an ancient martial arts warrior. Now you can be a ninja too. It's Randy Wozin's Ninja Suits for Halloween. Available in Midnight Black, Winter White, and Jungle Warrior Camouflage Ninja Suits. Yeah. Oh, geez. Easy, buddy, easy. Also, a full line of ninja and martial arts accessories as well. Yeah, take your nunchucks with you, huh? Let's wonder what it must be like to strap on a gun and pin on a badge and become a lady lawman. Well, your job's even tougher. Because everybody expects you. Expects you to take the easy way to avoid the hot coals, but not you.
shirt off, you stop some maggot for speeding. You walk up to the window. He jumps out of the car. He says, oh, wouldn't you know it, bad enough I get stopped for speeding, but I gotta get stopped by some dame. He says, maybe you could write me a ticket, lady, but let me tell you something. I never thought women should be police officers. They don't have the size. They don't have the stamina. They don't have the guts. They don't have the head for it. You look him right in the eye and say, you know another thing we don't have? He says, what? You say, a pair of these. And you reach out and you grab him and give him a good twist. Yeah, that maggot as he drops to his knees. And you start slamming his head against the side of his car. Whop, 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 whop. He says, stop it. Stop it. I'll turn you into Internal Affairs. And you jack him off the ground and you get your face right in his and say, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? Tell him a lady cop kicked your butt, huh? You're going to go downtown and say you were beaten up by a woman there. As you whap his head against the side of the car. Whop, whop, whop. And watch him slowly sink to the pavement as you walk back to your squad car and call it in. He's lying there blubbering. And suddenly the call comes back over the radio. Roger, 139, that's Kilo Bravo India 133, registered to a 1966 Bel Air coupe, one Halbert Brauman, wanted in three states for aggravated rape. Please detain and make ready for transport. Aggravated rape, you say? The charge that calls you the most out of all charges. You walk up to that maggot as you pull your nightstick out of its ring. You grab him and say, you maggot, how do you like it, huh? You lily-livered, spineless twit.